China is drilling the world's deepest hole in the name of science. I immediately found this fascinating because of research I was doing for another video. It turns out there's some really important materials deep in the Earth's crust. Plus, there have been some other drilling breakthroughs of late. So let's see if we can't figure this out together and see why China is actually investing in doing this. I'm Ricky, and this is 2-Bit Da Vinci. This video is brought to you by Delete Me. It turns out that we know more about the moon and Mars than we do about deep in the Earth's crust or the depths of our oceans. So on the surface, China's claims that this is the name of science does make sense. According to the Chinese state-run Xinhua News, a borehole drilling project began on June 23rd in the Tarim Basin Desert in China's northwestern Xinjiang region. The narrow shaft is planned to reach a depth of 11,100 meters, 36,400 feet, and penetrate more than 10 continental strata to reach the Cretaceous system of the Earth's crust, a rock layer that dates back over 145 million years. Remember that the Earth is like an onion made of different layers. The outermost layer is a crust, which is like the planet's thin skin. It's only about 25 miles thick on average. Beyond this is the 1,800-mile deep mantle, and beyond that, you arrive at the Earth's core. Well, the Chinese are digging a hole that'll bore into the first 7 miles of crust. To put that into perspective, if the Earth was the same diameter as your arm, it would be like making a hole about 1/50th of an inch, or half a millimeter deep, into your arm's skin. So while 36,000 feet sounds amazing, it is not very big in the whole grand scheme of things. The project is expected to take 457 days and is being called a landmark in China's deep Earth exploration by the Chinese media. So, why are they drilling this hole? The deep exploration will allow scientists to study the internal structure and evolution of the Earth and provide data for geoscience research, said China National Petroleum Corporation, the country's leading oil and gas producer, which is leading the project, in a statement. And there it is. I was wondering who's going to pay for all this, since most other deep drilling projects ultimately die due to lack of funding, and we'll get back to that in a minute. I'm all for science, but science isn't cheap, and in many cases it's funded by large corporations with deep pockets, like the oil and gas industry. While that isn't in and of itself a bad thing, especially if some good comes out of it, it does give us some hints about the project's real motives. The Xinjiang region is known for its rich mineral deposits and oil reserves. Recently, Sinopec, China's largest refining company, discovered significant oil and gas flows in an exploration well in the Tarim Basin at a depth of over 8,500 meters below the surface. Okay, so drilling in a region known for oil and gas deposits at depths of excess of 8,500 meters, it's kind of starting to make sense. But we gotta give credit where it's due. The project is part of China's effort to explore new frontiers in space and below the Earth's surface. In 2021, the Chinese president urged the country's leading scientists to break new barriers in different areas, including deep Earth exploration. And 2 years later, it's paying off. China already overtook the US to become the biggest contributor to Nature Science journals, in a sign of the country's growing influence in the world of academic research. But there's actually a lot more to this story, dating all the way back to the Cold War. You see, during the Cold War, besides the nuclear arms race and the first space race, deep Earth exploration was also seen as a showcase of a country's technological and engineering prowess. And for good reason. As you'll see here in a minute, it's incredibly challenging. Before we get into that, let's talk about our sponsor this week, Delete Me. Delete Me is a hands-free subscription service that will remove your personal information that's being sold online. Delete Me's privacy experts remove you from Google and 100+ data brokers all year long. Get a privacy report in 7 days. Remove all your personal information like phone and address. Monitor sites and repeat removal as needed, and users can even make custom removal requests. I've been a member now for almost 6 months, and I just got my second quarterly report. Staying private online is an ongoing battle. Just look at all the places Delete Me has removed my data, and where it's in progress. Truly amazing, and something none of us spend nearly enough time thinking about. With Delete Me, you don't have to. Let their team of experts scour the web and keep your personally identifiable information private. So stay a step ahead of your privacy online and save 20% on all plans with code Ricky with Delete Me. Links in description. Huge thanks to Delete Me and you for supporting the show. Let's talk about why I think China is making the investment, especially because I think you're going to be surprised. The first is geothermal energy. Geothermal is one of the most promising green energy solutions that could help us completely decarbonize our baseload power generation. You see, unlike wind and solar, which are intermittent, geothermal energy is a reliable power source that's on 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. The reason we don't use geothermal plants everywhere is that to make it economically viable, we need to access temperatures above 705 degrees Fahrenheit and pressures above 3200 PSI, where water becomes super critical. This is a special state where water is a mix between a liquid and a gas and is much better at extracting heat from the ground than either liquid water or vapor. So working at these temperatures makes the plant much more efficient, and you can only get to temperatures that high at shallow depths near volcanoes or fault lines. But if you could manage to drill deep enough and economically enough, you could access highly efficient geothermal energy literally anywhere on the face of the earth. And that would be an absolute game changer. And whoever gets there first, like every arms race, will have a clear advantage over the rest of the world. The second reason I see for China drilling this hole is raw material exploration. In 2021, China was the world's third largest producer of iron ore, only behind Australia and Brazil. Iron ore is the second largest market in the world, accounting for over $283 billion in 2022, second only to crude oil exports, which added up to $2.1 trillion. Iron ore is one of humanity's most important materials, and it's what makes our modern world possible, especially when alloyed into steel. China is also the world's largest steel producer. They single-handedly produce 1 billion tons of steel in 2022, which is 54% of the world's total production that year. But iron is only the tip of a very large iceberg. China's dominance in many other strategic metals and minerals is impressive. The European Critical Raw Materials Alliance classifies 30 raw materials that are absolutely vital to the world economy. Of those 30 critical raw materials, China ranks as the world's number one largest producer in 14 of the cases and the second largest producer in another two. This means that China literally dominates over half of all the most important critical raw materials on Earth. China produces over 90% of the world's rare earth metals. And rare earth metals are needed for powerful permanent magnets, which allow us to do all sorts of things in the world of electric motors, sensors, and large wind turbines, and even hybrid cars. Besides providing raw materials for their domestic industries, this dominance is important for China as leverage on the international stage. For example, only a couple days ago, on July 3rd, 2023, China announced restrictions on exports of gallium and germanium, which are widely used in the semiconductor industry. And this really comes into play in the world of the current chip wars, which we've covered in a recent video. We discussed how the US is actively undermining China's access to the most advanced computer chips by not allowing companies like ASML to sell their best chip-making machines to China. Now, China's striking back by cutting down the supply of raw materials. This is just one example of why mineral exploration is so important for China. They need to diversify as much as possible to remain relevant. Dubai made its wealth in oil and gas, but they know fossil fuels won't last forever. So they've built a thriving service and financial economy to diversify its income. That's how they're going to stay relevant for years to come. Now, this is really important because China has been the manufacturing heart of the planet for the last 50 years. But that's changing as the cost of living and labor rates are going up in China as their workforce is becoming more and more advanced. So does manufacturing. And now companies are moving to other countries like Vietnam, for example, for more of their manufacturing. So the first thing China could do is stop making things for other companies and let local Chinese companies start to dominate the market. And this is already happening with companies like DJI, one of the best companies that make drones and camera equipment. They're just dominant. And there's a ton of other companies like that. Another example of the rare materials that come into play here is iridium. Iridium is one of the rarest elements in the Earth's crust, and it's easy to understand why. It is so dense a metal that it's constantly sinking into the Earth's core. So in theory, the deeper you drill, the more likely you'll find more iridium. And it turns out iridium is one of the best catalysts for hydrogen production using electrolysis. If China wants to get an even stronger footing in the hydrogen economy, controlling more and more of the global iridium production is definitely a smart move. Finally, we have scientific research. If you're wondering why we know so much about drilling already, it's because this new drilling project won't be the deepest humans have ever drilled. That distinction goes to the Kola Superdeep borehole in northwest Russia with a depth of 40,200 feet. finished in 1989 after 20 years of drilling. This exploration brought a slew of important discoveries. For example, the temperature at the bottom of the borehole was 180 degrees Celsius, much higher than the expected 100. Rock samples from 3 kilometers deep turned out to be almost identical to moon rocks, suggesting that the moon was once a part of the Earth and got chipped away by an asteroid or something similar millions of years ago. There was also water discovered at depths of more than 10 kilometers, which was surprising because it was thought that water could not exist at such high pressures. There were fossils of microorganisms in rocks as old as 2.7 billion years, which suggested that life existed in the Precambrian era. And there were gases such as hydrogen and methane in the rocks, which could have been produced by chemical reactions or biological activity. This goes to show how little we actually know about the Earth's crust, let alone the mantle or even the core. I used to think that we knew a lot more about the core and that we had actually collected samples and studied them, but it turns out that we have barely scratched the surface. In fact, just a couple of weeks ago, we managed to drill through the Earth's mantle for the first time in human history, and that was a deep sea drilling experiment in one of the thinnest parts of the Earth's crust in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean. The question is, why? Why is it so hard to drill deep into the Earth? As it turns out, drilling at these depths comes with a slew of engineering challenges. The most important challenges of drilling miles into the Earth is related to how hard and hot the rocks get down there. The top layer of Earth's crust is rather soft and easy to punch through with traditional, low-cost, rotary drilling equipment. However, when you hit basement rock, you need harder bits to chew through the rock. The big challenge is that as things get hotter, most materials like steel and tungsten carbide lose many of their properties, turning softer, which makes them wear out more quickly. Besides the obvious added cost of having to constantly replace drilling bits, it can also take a couple of days to replace. The second big limiting factor is the weight of the shaft itself. We need to be able to pull out the entire shaft every time we have to replace a bit. And that means that A, the shaft must be able to withstand its own weight. B, we have heavy machinery on the surface capable of lifting the entire weight of the drilling equipment. Making the shafts thicker to make them stronger doesn't work because it adds more weight, which offsets the added strength almost exactly. So the only real solution is to use stronger, lighter, and more expensive metal alloys. But there is a limit to how hard we can make these alloys because the harder metals become, they usually also become more brittle and break more easily. The next big challenge is pressure and stopping the borehole from collapsing. Whenever you go down into the Earth's crust, every foot you drill increases pressure, not on the hole itself, but on the surrounding walls of rock because it has another foot of rock pressing down upon it. This pressure tends to make the walls of the hole collapse. To avoid this, we need to inject a fluid into the well to balance the pressure and stabilize the hole. This fluid is pumped through a drilling shaft. It mixes with the debris from the drilling bit and pushes it up to the surface as a drilling mud. At a depth of 7 miles into the Earth, pressures will rise to almost 240 megapascals, which is about 35,000 pounds per inch. To give you some context, the pressure that imploded the Titan a few weeks ago near the Titanic wreckage was around 6,000 psi, and the pressure at the bottom of the Marianas Trench, 17,750 psi. So a well this deep would have a pressure twice that of the deepest point in the ocean's floor. We need massive pumps to pressurize and move that fluid down and up 7 miles. Not easy at all, and it may not even be possible, since there's a limit to how heavy we can make the mud. The way drilling companies solve many of these drilling challenges is by starting with a wide hole, which is lined with steel to hold the hole open and sustain the pressure. Then you run a smaller drill bit inside the outer jacket to keep boring, and you line the hole with more steel and make the bit smaller and smaller as you go deeper into the earth. This means that engineers need to plan just how deep they want to reach, because as these jackets continually get smaller, that will determine just how far they can reach. But sometimes during drilling, we'll hit spots of higher pressure than we anticipated, or an unstable part of the geology, and will be forced to line the hole earlier than expected. This can cause a blowout, which is game over for the crews on top and the entire drilling operation. Fortunately, there are new technologies that could change all of this by replacing the rotary mechanical drilling bit with a powerful energy beam. An MIT spinoff company called Quaze is using a gyrotron, which is a machine used in nuclear fusion experiments to shoot millimeter wave energy beams that can literally vaporize any kind of rock. The cool thing about this technology is that it doesn't have moving parts that wear off. It can withstand extremely high temperatures since it doesn't depend on the material's mechanical properties, and it doesn't need drilling mud to stabilize the borehole. This last bit is because as it vaporizes the rock, it literally carterizes or turns the hole's walls into glass. With this technology, Quays believes it can drill as deep as 12.4 miles into the earth, doubling China's target depth. Not only that, but it'll also do so much faster. China claims they'll be able to reach their target depth in 457 days, or in about a year and 3 months. This is almost 16 times faster than the Soviet Kola Deep Superhole took 20 years ago. But Quays claims they can drill a 12-mile deep hole in just 100 days, which is almost 10 times faster than what the Chinese are planning to do. Not only that, but the cost savings in time and in expensive drilling bits and shafts will also make Quays' drilling technology much cheaper than conventional drilling. According to Paul Waskov from MIT Plasma Science and Fusion Center, an 8-inch wide, 10-kilometer deep hole would cost around $500,000 worth of electricity using the gyrotron death ray, whereas the cost of a traditional drilling apparatus at that depth would cost around $30 million. So we're talking about 60 times cheaper drilling. Not bad at all. In the world of engineering, science, and business, as new breakthroughs come along, we shift the materials that we need, right? In the age of lithium-ion batteries and electric cars, suddenly you need lithium and nickel, and the demand and the consumption of nickel and lithium have absolutely skyrocketed. In the future, if we want to have a hydrogen economy, we're going to need iridium. And where is that going to come from? Because there is so little on Earth, especially, that's accessible to us. So as you look forward, you should always be thinking about how industries will shift the makeup of what materials that we need. Like we mentioned, iron. Without iron, if iron wasn't so abundant on Earth, we wouldn't have all the bridges and all the structures and cars that we have today. And in the case of China, I think what they are doing is just like back in the Cold War or in previous times, they're seeing deep earth exploration as a true frontier and a showcase of just how capable they are. And I really think it does make sense to invest in this. As I mentioned, China is kind of transitioning. They're no longer just manufacturing everything for everyone because the labor rates are going up and other cheaper countries are going to start taking over that crown. So what does China do? Well, they go from making other people's stuff to making their own stuff. Companies like DJI. How about the invasion of electric vehicles? We're about to see something that didn't happen in the gasoline car era. Chinese automakers doing massive levels of exporting to other countries. That didn't happen before, but it's about to. The number of Chinese EV startups and companies like BYD and NIO, XPeng, there are so many companies now that want to enter this space, and it's going to completely shift the economics. So I think their plan is to look at what they want to do in the future and figure out how they can have access to the minerals that they need. Because every end product that you see is not possible without every bit of tungsten and copper and gold and platinum needed to make it. So that is a look at what we think China's up to. But obviously, there's not a lot of information that we know. If we learn more, we'll share it with all of you guys. And if you thought this was cool and interesting, you gotta check out this video next.